Hello and welcome to the Holy Hour Podcast. It's the bi-weekly All Cure Podcast. I'm Gavin, and I hope everybody's doing good out there. Welcome, in North America anyway, to summer. It is officially here. Kiddos are out of school. It is getting hot, hot, hot by the minute. I'm sweating more and more each day and realizing, oh, I wish it was spring or fall. But let's enjoy it. Let's embrace the summer. And, you know, speaking of summer, I thought it'd be fun to do a feature episode. And I started thinking about producers, maybe. Maybe we'll pick an individual producer and talk about that producer in good details, because they don't get a lot of love, you know, those wonderful producers of Cure albums, co-producers, I guess I should say. I'd been talking with my brother a lot. We've been having these great discussions. He had just recently seen the Beach Boys documentary on Disney Plus and got really into it and convinced me to watch it. I like the Beach Boys. I love Pet Sounds, but I don't really extend too far beyond that. You know, the little surfer girl kind of songs are, they're all right. And I know their place in history, but I can't say I really put them on that often, enjoy them. So we got in all these kind of Beatles versus Beach Boys discussion, and mostly of that kind of stemmed off of the idea of the production of these really groundbreaking albums like Pet Sounds and Revolver and Sgt. Pepper and stuff, and these ones that you can really hear. Thing is stemmed off of these groundbreaking production done on these albums, and you know, so we went back and forth, me being more in favor of the Beatles production and stuff, but there's no doubt there's some crazy amazing stuff going on Pet Sounds in particular. So that got me thinking back on Cure stuff is like, well, why talk about just one when we can kind of do a quick run through of all the Cure's producers and give them all the love there and try to give a run through. So it won't be, you know, be kind of 101 level, but we're going to try to cover all the Cure's producers, do a little feature on them, and try to put the full scope of things on how these Cure albums that we love and adore had been sculpted or assisted by these producers or co-producers. So what do you say? Should we get into some production talk? Let's do it. And, you know, maybe the best way to start is for those out there that aren't as music savvy. What is the actual role of a producer in terms of making an album? And really, I kind of thought the best way to describe it is it's almost like more common knowledge of what the director of a film does. So it's kind of different terms, but the same idea. It definitely varies depending on the producer and their skill set, but mostly the ideas man or ideas woman behind an album. And they do everything from arranging the composition, meaning they might suggest cutting out the intro or putting the last verse first or doubling a chorus at the end, stuff like that. But also it runs or directs the whole recording session, really, suggesting which instruments could be used and where. Say you want to swap out a guitar for a piano part, or which room these mics and which certain mics might work best, and what effects to even put on it. Sometimes they even suggest rearranging lyrics, so rewording something so it doesn't sound awkward could be part of it. Guiding or directing other crucial members of the production. So we have a team in there usually, and part of that is the engineer. That's kind of the first level, the person hands-on with all the tweaks and knobs, if you will, back in the day anyway. And the faders, you see the guy fading parts up and down, and the actual setting up of the mics and doing all the drums and getting the drums in the right spots and everything. So that's all done by the engineer, while your producer's the guy standing behind him with his hands on his chin going, I like it, but let's do another take, you know, something like that. And when it's all tracked and done, then you bring in a mixer. He's kind of the next role there. And, you know, of course, all these vary. You could have an engineer that's also producing and then ends up also mixing it. Or they bring in, say they got an engineer and a producer, then they bring in another mixer to mix it with the three people, or however you know, there's going to be variations on this, but you need another mixer in there, or somebody's going to mix it. And the idea of mixing it is when you tweak all the tracks to get the sounds that you want exactly. That's usually more like fixing EQ and effects and balancing it all out and bringing parts in and out and stuff like that when you mix it. It's crazy how much you can change a song just by mixing it completely different. If you cut out like just a guitar part or something, you can get a whole different mix out of something. You all heard alt mixes of things, I'm sure, and you know how important it is. You can totally fuck a song up if you mix it poorly. So very important to have three very capable people doing this, or one really awesome person that does all that. The only real close connection I have in my early days, I wish I had worked with him later, but a wonderful guy in Fredericksburg, Virginia, named Jeff Covert, works at Wally Cleaver Studios, and won all kinds of awards, and he was a hands-on guy that would be a professional producer. So he would do it all, engineer it, produce it, and then we'd mix it together and stuff. But it's crazy that when you have somebody in there like that, you know, you're really paying for their ears and their experience and such too. Just the way this guy could hear if something was slightly out of tune or just sounded weird or would have these awesome ideas. The last time I really worked with him, I was doing like a solo record with him. So I'd play the song to like a click track and then we would just build it together. And it was awesome because he'd have all these great ideas of like, what about a banjo? Let's add that in. And then, no, that sounds weird. So let's take it out. And, you know, it's very cool and fun as hell. I wish I could afford to just do that constantly. But at a certain point, you just kind of learn how to do that on your own to save money. But, you know, no matter how good or how many years I spent doing it, it would never compare to working with a professional like this. So it is a really impressive job. The people that are awesome at it, I don't know, it's like a whole other art form. And I have all the respect in the world to these producers because not only do they know how to do all the gear and engineer stuff usually, but then they can put it all together. Then they can have the artistic side of knowing what makes your song work best. They might have only heard that song that day even, but already they could twist it and flavor it up so it sounds the best that it could be. So it's very cool. And something that you can't really put on a resume even is one of the jobs of a producer is creating the right atmosphere or mood for an album. Some are like super laid back and they let the band just do whatever they want and then help create the mood from that. Others have very strict rules when they come into it in a format and a pattern in which that's their thing and you're entering their world if you want to record with that producer. And, you know, naturally that could cause a ton of problems if the band isn't aware of this format that they're getting into. So much like movie directors and actors, musicians and producers, they either often bond very well with each other or it's a complete nightmare. And we'll see with The Cure, often a band either does mesh with them and keep using that same producer for numerous albums or, you know, it's a one and done kind of thing. You notice drastic changes in a band a lot of times if they use a producer for numerous albums and then it shifts to a different producer. A lot of times you're like, what the fuck happened to their sound? It just sounds weird. And, you know, a lot of times it was intentional or sometimes it's not, you know, and then it could really affect the way the band is perceived from that point on. And then they go back to use that producer sometimes if they're like, oh, wait, we were just doing our experimental record, something like that. And often bands like to challenge themselves by picking somebody that doesn't do their normal thing when they hit that point where they want to spice it up and do something different and work with a producer that has a reputation for doing something different. So you'll see that with The Cure even. And it doesn't fix their regular sound, and sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. Often the producer is chosen based on previous albums that they have done with artists that the band likes or admires for whatever reason. As with The Cure, often a producer will emerge from an already existing position on the team. Like they're working with a producer and the engineer impresses them. And eventually on the next album, they'll work with the engineer as the main producer. So a lot of times they're already in the camp, if you will, but something wins them over and they pull them all out. With The Cure, it's also important to remember that these are all co-producers. Our man Robert Smith is a huge factor in all the production of this. And because he's cool about not really going into who did what and what, you know, we don't know if it's a 60-40, 50-50, 90-10%. But Robert is yet to fully produce an album by himself, which is pretty shocking, really, because you know that he really has the chops to do it, but he prefers to have somebody in there to bounce these ideas off of and to work with. I think it probably does vary, as you'll probably get the pickup on the vibe too as we go through each producer. Like, some of them he was probably calling the shots for a bit more, and people were kind of like, sure, Robert, that's a great idea. And, you know, contributed stuff, I'm sure, but Robert was probably the main of the two. Early on, I think it was probably a different story where he really was working with the person and learning a lot still, and, you know, kind of bouncing his ideas off of them, and they were calling the shots, or at least keeping him on the specific vision, if you will. But, as they say, enough of my yakking, let's boogie. First producer was none other than Chris Perry, a logical first producer for The Cure. Chris Perry, you know, is kind of by default. He took the band into the studio 2 weeks after they signed to Fiction, after he had pulled them out, discovered them basically, and got them on their feet. Of course, he's going to produce them. He's their manager. He's their whole shebang there. And Robert didn't really have enough knowledge, you know, at this point to pull any... you know, I want to produce it on the first album. Nobody does that. So not even the great Robert Smith. So it made sense that he would produce it with, and this was just full on Chris Perry too. Robert doesn't even get a co-producing on this one. It's the only one he's not involved with the production on. And while the approach to the album was very low budget and simple, post-punk, yeah, pretty straightforward, they did have disagreements on the sound. Robert quickly learned that he did not want Chris Perry producing any more Cure albums from this point on, or even being in the studio, as we would hear in quotes. He just didn't want him in there even. And, you know, it's kind of understandable. It's like having your dad in there or something, you know, or it's just, I don't know what the ideas were that were, you know, contrasting with Robert and Chris Perry at this point. But he wasn't too thrilled with it. He's mentioned that he isn't crazy about the production of the first album, but I think he, you know, kind of nailed what it is. Straightforward, post-punk, you know, how they sound live, pretty much. No frills kind of sound. Robert would later say Chris Perry hears things as singles or as a first-time listener, which is why it is much more valuable bringing him in to listen to a song rather than working with him. He's got a very good ear. So there you see that Robert respects his opinions as, you know, evaluating the songs when they're finished. As we would see in Cure history, he does do a really good job of picking the best singles for the most part and, you know, kind of telling them when they need to pull their shit together as a listener, you know, and what's going to be the best for the band. But as far as the experimental ear and ideas in the studio, I guess that's probably where they clashed. So in addition to the whole Three Imaginary Boys album, Chris Perry would produce the singles Killing an Arab, Boys Don't Cry, Jumping Someone Else's Train. Jumping ahead, he would actually come back and do a couple more Cure songs as the producer. Let's Go to Bed, he returns for it in Just One Kiss, which, you know, maybe that's why it helped to make a pop single with him, because he was swinging for the fences, if you will, or putting on more of a listener perspective of how this album should be produced. And somehow he ends up with a co-producing on the top too with Dave Allen and Robert Smith, but we'll get to that in the future. On to the next producer, we have Mike Hedges. And Mike Hedges is interesting because he's the first that was an engineer on Three Imaginary Boys. So he was probably working in there with him, and I would almost assume that Robert probably clicked with the engineer while you got Chris Perry and hovering around behind you giving suggestions. They're all rolling their eyes and they decide, all right, for the next album, 17 Seconds, I want Mike Hedges being the producer. Chris Perry can wait back in the office there. And somehow Chris Perry agreed to it. He was very understanding And not only not being the producer or co-producer, but being banned from the studio, basically. So Robert got his first taste of producer control already on the second album, co-producing with Mike Hedges, recorded in just 2 weeks and mixed at another. Robert and Hedges set up the studio to their preference and vision and left it that way entirely for the sessions, giving the record a very cohesive feel and arguably officially launching the real Cure archetypal sound. A quote from Christian Gerard's FAQ book, it said, "Hedges, Robert, and his assistant Mike Dutton created a very specific drum sound for 17 seconds, mixing them in such a way to get that super dry and snappy sound that you hear on the album. A snare 3-drum pad was used, the same one used on Devo's Whip It and Cars by Gary Numan, along with the flange and delay effects and all that juicy effects that we've come to love from Cure songs." So they really had a vision, they locked it down, and they nailed it because they were working great together. And Mike Hedges is able to pull all those resources together and get the sound that Robert was going for. The songs are really well rehearsed too, was another huge issue for this album. Having toured a bunch right before it, I think that really freed up a lot of time to experiment with the sounds and get the exact sound they wanted in the studio, as opposed to dicking around with the actual song arrangements and such and trying to get them finalized. They were pretty much locked in how they wanted them. They just needed to get that sound. And yeah, this really helped launch Mike Hedges' career immensely, making him suddenly an in-demand producer too. So 17 Seconds really got some good praise for the production. Hard to tell which was first. He also did an Associates album, The Affectionate Punch, in 1980. But either way, this is one of Mike Hedges' first albums produced, and which we'll also see a slight pattern of with Cure producers. And he would return for the next album, Faith, in 1981. But the session didn't go as smoothly right from the start. Moods and tempers started to flare. Hedges had a much harder time on this album keeping the band moving forward. While there were disagreements, it's pretty obvious that the band just nearly wasn't as well rehearsed for this one. Basically writing the bulk of the songs in the studio, like I was saying, wasting a lot of the time and money just getting the songs together as you're recording them in pieces and such. It's not a good idea. I feel like every producer I've known has always said, have the songs ready. You can always dissect them more once you get them in there. But if you're trying to write the damn thing while sitting in there, it turns into Spinal Tap all of a sudden. So if he knew the fucking part, he'd play it. So yeah, not as confident in their approach either. You know, Robert really had a set vision for that one. He initially said that Faith was even going to be a peppier album at one point when he had written Primary and such. And as soon as they wrote All Cats Are Grey and Funeral Party, the mood just drastically shifted and morphed into this very drastically somber tone, and it did not recover from. Robert would be quoting and saying, "If we left it up to Mike Hedges to fully produce, it would be really demented. He's always wanting to go really over the top." So it seems like, and we can tell from listening to the final product of Faith, that Mike Hedges is all about keeping it simple, but still pushing the envelope and being open to experimenting. While there were struggles recording this album, I think every Cure fan pretty much would agree that he did such a great job of keeping them on track and making Faith cohesive as fuck. I mean, this is perhaps the most cohesive of all Cure albums. There's definitely a mood that carries through this whole thing and really nails it and further alongs that classic Cure sound, if you will. Just more complex layers, a lot with a little though. You know, there isn't like a billion layers like you would get with later Cure albums, but enough there and enough atmosphere built around it to really carry the mood, using that bass six, you know, working that in for the first time. And even Chris Perry, who had like set a deadline and cut funding by the end of this thing because it was dragging on too much, ultimately even recognized that the final album, though, was pretty damn impressive. So while it took a little while to get there, at least the final product was gold as far as everyone is concerned. And sadly, it did pretty much end Mike Hedges' relationship there as co-producer of future Cure albums. It wasn't completely done yet. They would do one more single, Charlotte Sometimes. Despite the friction during the Faith sessions, they kept Mike Hedges around. For some reason, they said that it needed to be recorded. All the books made it sound like there was too much time passing and they needed to get another single out, which I don't really get because it's in the same year even. But nonetheless, they reunited to record Charlotte Sometimes, and while it's hardly a Cyndi Lauper pop tune, Charlotte Sometimes definitely feels more poppier than most of the tunes on Faith. And again, captures that perfect dark era, early 80s Cure vibe. Rumor has it they recorded it in one take, even though the band was clearly pretty exhausted by this point. But if you want to get exhausted, how about you read the rest of the albums produced by Mike Hedges in the future? This is just a little handful of some great albums that he's produced or co-produced throughout his career. The Beat, Hit It, Bauhaus, Mask, The Associates, Sulk, many Susie and the Banshees albums, including A Kiss in the Dream House, Hyena, which would reunite him with Robert, Through the Looking Glass, all the Creatures albums, The Laws, Lush's first couple albums, Manic Street Preachers, Everything Must Go, Travis, The Man Who, personal favorite album, U2, All That You Can't Leave Behind, and How to Dismantle a Bomb. Multiple albums with Mark Allman and Everything But the Girl, and they did that huge Dido album, Life for Rent, you know that one? Yeah, he did that too. Music for Harry Potter films. You ever heard of Harry Potter? Yeah, he did music for those. And actually even crossed paths with The Cure again, doing that cover of Love, the John Lennon tune, for a tribute album in 2005. And also did some work on Torn Down, a remix, in 2018. But as we jump back into the actual Cure timeline, post-Charlotte Sometimes, the relationship was strained enough where they would not have Mike Hedges be co-producer on any other official full-length Cure album again. This time, as they started to set their eyes on the project of Pornography, Robert mentioned a desire to have someone new for production on the record. The real deciding factor was, though, that Mike Hedges was taking a producer gig for A Kiss in the Dream House by the Banshees, so that kind of made the decision easy. He wasn't available anyway for the Cure album, so they would have to find somebody, and they wanted to find a young fellow or somebody around the same age, and they did in Phil Thornalley, yes, who'd later become known as Da Vinci. He was a triple threat, a producer, an engineer with experience, a skilled musician, an accomplished songwriter. Born January 5th, 1960, just a little younger than Robert Smith. At the age of 18, he started studio work as an engineer in 1978 at Rack Studios in St. John's Wood, London, working under legendary producers Mickey Post, Steve Lillywhite, and Alex Sadkin. Pretty much all his production work would be based out of Rack Studios. Starting out as mostly an engineer, he would also do some mixing and quickly work his way up to producing his first official album, or co-producing it anyway, with The Cure. Much like Mike Hedges, his first deal in 1982. And it sounds like Steve Lillywhite himself, who had produced U2, Peter Gabriel, Kirsty MacColl, Morrissey, all kinds of great stuff, puts in a good word for Phil, and upon meeting Robert and Chris Perry, they clicked fairly quickly. The appeal to Robert was that he was a younger, or at least closer to his age, producer, and I think more willing to let Robert dictate the vibe, if you will. When we talked to Phil in episode 185 that you should go check back out, he made it sound like that he was hired on mostly as just an engineer, and quickly he started giving good input to Robert and clicked working well with him with ideas and such. and then was given credit as being a co-producer after it all wrapped up. So maybe sometimes they don't really know right off the bat, and they just see how it goes. And if they feel like they collaborated enough, it becomes a co-produce. Otherwise, he would have just been engineer credits. The sessions, well, they're pretty dark, as you'd imagine, mostly based on the booze and the drugs. But Phil was the straight one through it all, keeping it together, and felt, despite the debauchery, the band were really tight and well rehearsed again. The songs had been locked down before coming in, and this allowed Phil time to create an atmosphere for the record and capture Robert's ideas or interpret them together as they really locked down a feel for the record. When you hear the live versions of songs from Pornography, it's cool to see that that's probably what they brought into the studio and how thin but cool they are. And then Phil and Robert created all that cool atmosphere and background sound and sonic bliss that really gives Pornography the weight and muscle that it has. They'd use big wooden rooms for the drums. They double tracked the bass on a lot of them, he'd said, and just kind of went out of his way to credit the band for not being just well rehearsed, but also having really well written songs. And, you know, that's kind of Phil's main thing, especially later in his career, is what an expert songwriter he is. And he really caught on to that, I think, and was able to bring out the best in these well-written songs. He would say in our talk that if the song's shit, you can only do so much with it. You know, you can dress up a pig or a turd, I think it was some kind of expression like that. You can roll a turd in glitter, I think he said, but it's still a turd. But these were just great songs, so it was easy to create an atmosphere and really bring them to life. As we all know, The Cure would basically implode after the tour for Pornography. Simon was out. Robert and Lowell would go on to make some pop singles, the first being Let's Go to Bed. Again, that was produced by Chris Perry and Robert in 83. They would do The Walk, which was produced by Steve Nye, who we'll get to. And it was around this time that Phil would agree to joined The Cure as a touring bassist because Simon was still gone. And during this touring, they would go around and pause in Paris at one point in 83 to record the Love Cat single, which had Speak My Language and Mr. Pink Eyes on it as well. And he would not only produce that single, but would also play bass on it. And the tracks would be later mixed back at Rack Studios by Dave Allen, and Thornalley would call, "This was the best time that I had with The Cure. I was doing what I do best. I was producing, I was playing bass. It was just a great session. Given my background as a pop person, Love Cats was my moment when I felt I really got to shine with The Cure. It was the best record I ever made with them, mainly because everybody enjoyed it." So really, just in the short amount of time, Phil got to produce the two extremes of The Cure sound, the poppiest of pop and the darkest of dark. Pornography to Love Cats, literally. Love Cats would be officially credited as Phil Thornalley, Chris Perry, and Robert Smith somehow. So I'm not sure how Chris Perry got in on it. I think it's pretty safe to assume that between Phil and Robert, the bulk of the real work was covered. But, you know, give him the credit. Why not? A funny side note when we talked to Phil, he said, although he gets praised for the recording and playing and producing of Love Cats, the song really came together when a young fella named Dave Allen stepped in to help out and record the brass and mix it. So this is the first introduction of Dave Allen to the Cure world. And later when we talked to Dave Allen, he, of course, would praise Phil, saying that Phil did all the work. I just put the final touches on it. And, you know, so further confirming what sweet and super humble guys both of them are. And but let's not jump ahead to Dave just yet. So more praising for Phil. For the sake of time, we'll sprint through his highlights of his career because we'd be here all night. But he's nominated for a Grammy as an engineer for the Thompson Twins' Into the Gap album. Did some engineering for Duran Duran, produced Wax, Magnetic Heaven in 88, and also put out a solo album, Swamp. Took over lead vocal duties for the band Johnny Hates Jazz in 91. And would strike gold in the late 90s with his song Torn, which had been co-written 6 years earlier and a couple of versions recorded prior, but Aussie soap star Natalie Imbruglia made the song a certified hit as Cap Song of the Year winner, actually, in 1998, and it still gets played constantly on pop radio. Back Here was another hit penned by Phil that would explode on the pop charts in 99. When I'm back here, baby. So we have Phil to thank for that one. As well as writing hits for Pixie Lott and everyone's favorite Canadian tuxedo-wearing legend, Bryan Adams. Around 2018, Phil would return to writing and recording and producing his own jams with his Astral Drive project. Just put out a new solo album, actually, in March. That's called Hollywood. You can find that on all streaming services. Go check it out. Phil always seems to be having a great time and is one of my absolute favorite people to follow on Instagram. So I highly recommend you track him down and see what he's up to still to this day. Let's move back a little bit in the timeline. We had mentioned The Walk, one of those singles, those one-off pop singles. This one was produced by Steve Nye, and he would also do The Upstairs Room, The Dream, and Lament 2.0 version. His later work, he would be known for recording such artists, prior, Fleetwood Mac doing the Penguin album in 73, Brian Ferry in Your Mind in 77, XTC. He did Japan, Tin Drum, which they're always talking about Japan and their production. So that one must have been a favorite of Robert's. And Frank Zappa's Joe's Garage album are his other credits. So Dave Allen enters the picture. Later would be nicknamed Dirk. Not quite sure what that's in reference to. But Dirk, Dave M. Allen, David M. Allen, all the names, whatever you want to call him, would become The Cure's next co-producer. He is responsible for the entire golden era of The Cure's albums. The Top, Head on the Door, Kiss Me, Kiss Me, Kiss Me, Disintegration, Wish, Chemistry, Timing, Pure Expertise, call it what you need to. But when you say The Cure's producer, Dave Allen is pretty much the one on the top of the list. Perhaps the most impressive through line for all these albums is that no matter how diverse they are, they're all cohesive as fuck. As impressive as every little detail in Disintegration's cohesiveness is, it's almost more impressive when there are albums like Kiss Me and Wish, where they have a wide range of absolute pop gems mixed in with some of their most heartbreaking, gut-wrenching, sad tunes. And somehow, it still all fits together. And you've got your George Martins and Phil Spector, but in the Cure universe, it's Dave Allen all day. Born in Twickenham, 1959, like pretty much all the others starting out, was an engineer. Early highlights include working with Devo's 1977 cover of The Stones' Satisfaction and becoming Martin Rushent's understudy at Genetic Studios, where he got to engineer the Human League album, Dare, in 1981. His first exposure, though, in the Cure world came in engineering that Love Cat single with Phil, as we mentioned previously. So when The Top came around, he inherited most of the tracks, as he would say, and really just pieced it together from Robert's recordings and mixed it. So seemed like a fun and productive session for Dave anyway. He spoke fondly of it. Robert, of course, was hopping around taxis, going back and forth, making Susie and the Banshees album and losing his mind. But it seemed like a pretty good experience for Dave, and they clicked, most importantly. So they would bring him on to work on Head on the Door. He would mention different drum sets in all the songs. Every song had a different setup for the drums. And a bit time-consuming and a bit of a hassle, but at the same time, very cool. And a great experience. By Kiss Me, Kiss Me, they would set up two different drum rooms. One would be a stone room and one a wooden room. And he said in the stone room, you'd have stuff like Kiss and Fight and the harsher rock songs. In the wood room, of course, Catch and other ones. A critic called Kiss Me, Kiss Me, Kiss Me shambolic in a review, which not only kind of pissed him off, but also inspired him. There, I said, all right, you want a cohesive album? I'll show you cohesive. And on the next album, Disintegration, it was super tedious, but epic as shit with all the album sounds. Use the perfect snare hit and kick hit for every beat of the drums on that album. Check out the interview. We talked to him about that. He'll explain it a little bit better, but what they did is basically a sample, I guess, like the actual drum hits, and go back and use that as a trigger. So every time that Boris would hit the snare or the kick drum, it would use that perfect hit sound that he liked. So that's got to add a huge layer of cohesiveness to the whole album, because every hit is the same. Genius. And they wouldn't do that again for Wish, but would still capture a really impressive, cohesive sound for that record as well. He did all the recording and rough mixes of the final album of Wish, but did not do the final mix. But really, it was just to save time, because the album was running long. They needed it out. There was no way he wanted to get into, I think, the mess of trying to mix like Disintegration, but Wish. So they passed the mixing duty on to Mark Saunders. You know, most people don't complain about the mix of Wish, but you can't help but want, you know, Dave Allen to finish what he started. So he inherited the top, disinherited Wish, as he'd say. So unfortunately, that was the end of David Allen with The Cure, you know, citing a lot of it just kind of burnt out relations with Disintegration, a very intense album to record, as you would imagine, just kind of run its course by the time Wish came around. But would be credited in saying that he would gladly work with The Cure again someday, somehow. And had only nice things to say about his memories and time working with Robert. Beyond The Cure, Dave Allen's resume again shines bright. And we'd be here all night if I really went into all the details of it. But Sisters of Mercy, First and Last and Always, was produced by Dave Allen. The Chameleons, Strange Times, and Why Call It Anything, The Associates, Waiting for the Love Boat, Wire, Manscaped, The Damned, Frente, Nina Cherry, Mission, Psychedelic Furs, that album Book of Days, he did that one too. And in 2022, Dave released The DNA of DMA on the Them Say label, the album of originals that he wrote and recorded way back at the start when I was saying he was engineering the Human League album, Dare. He was tasked with setting up all the new gear and getting it all ready before the recording session started. So in doing so, he used his original songs to demo the use of this gear, and it's amazing and is out there on streaming, so you guys should check it out. So as we mentioned, Mark Saunders took over the mixing duties of Wish, and he deserves a mention too. Even though he didn't officially produce a full album, he did do the Never Enough single and Wrong Numbers singles, along with a ton of other remixes. So yeah, single mixes is kind of a whole weird thing in itself. They tend to be the ones that we hear all the time on the radio or used in the music videos. And they're even the ones they put on the greatest hits half the time. But differences are usually super subtle, but they are different. And, you know, there's just certain little tricks they have to make it pop for the masses, if you will, on radio. And it's slightly odd that Mark Saunders didn't totally take over as the next Cure producer at that point, as he seemed to be fitting the bill. But he would not return to produce Wild Mood Swings, just Wrong Number later on for Galore. And yeah, it's very odd. And I guess, you know, he's just more of a singles guy. Maybe there's a reason for it. And it's weird at this point. It's a good time to pause as we start heading towards Wild Mood Swings. When compiling all these people, it does strike me as that co-producer name seems to shift at this point. You know, Phil and Dave Allen are very, like I said, humble people that were very much give Robert credit for the co-producing that he does. So it's hard to say who's doing the heavy lifting as far as the producing job on these, or if it really was kind of 50-50, or, you know, they give Robert all the credit in the world. But at the same time, it really does feel like it shifts at this point where Robert kind of takes over the producing. You know, maybe that's not fair to say to these other producers, but I feel like it becomes Robert calling the shots a bit more, and they're kind of going along with it, and they're saying, yeah, it's a great idea. But it gets a little harder to challenge Robert after the success of Disintegration and Wish, I think, you know? He starts turning into the Phantom Menace where nobody wants to tell George Lucas, maybe we should back it off a little bit, you know? This guy can't do wrong. So basically, maybe they're like, well, who am I to tell him, though? He knows how to make Cure records by this point. So I'm along for the ride. I'll give him my input, take it or leave it kind of thing. But while Mood Swings emerges and they grab Steve Lyon, Robert had been a fan of his work with Depeche Mode, where he had been an engineer and violator in Songs of Faith and Devotion. Also from Twickenham, South London, Steve seemed to be the natural heir to Dave Allen, but sadly this wouldn't prove to be the case. Robert would say in an interview, "What we lost with Dave Allen was his knowledge of our limitations, but in some ways it helped working with someone we didn't know. In the past, when I'd been singing, no one knew what to expect, not even me. I've done it, I've listened to it, and worked on it. This time, I've had to think about a lot more of what I'm going to do, and I've really tried not to make so many mistakes so it doesn't come out sounding horrendous or embarrassing to me." So what I think all that translates to is that Steve Lyon let Robert take a bit too much control, maybe, of the production. And Robert would later say, "Steve Lyon is credited as co-producer because I'm generous." Yeesh. So given the insane amount of time and money Wild Mood Swings took to make, it does make sense that cohesive isn't a word associated with Wild Mood Swings ever. So much so that even work on it led into the theme of the album. Like, oh, it's supposed to be all over the place. It's wild. And at the end of the day, they ran out of time and sparked this decision to outsource the mixing of all the songs to a wide range of producers to do the final mixes, and further giving the album a more convoluted feel because 20 other people mixed it. So a lot of disjointed blame also tends to fall on the fact that when they're auditioning drummers, they were recording the album while it was going on. So they would have a song ready and they'd be auditioning the drummers and recording the drum parts. And some of those actually ended up on the fucking album. So of course you're going to have a different feel with multiple drummers on it. So the songwriting and the playing, you know, is all fine. That aside, a lot of the album's weaknesses are in the production. There's just too many layers, too many weird ass tones going, too many like 90s vibes going, over the top, overly cranked vocals. It's easy to blame the new guy, Steve Lyon, but in all actuality, maybe Robert just didn't have the right person to tell him when to knock it off. One of the few cases of somebody that breaks into the Cure universe and doesn't stick around or resurface. There's no documented tales of burnt bridges or anything or blow-ups with each other, but it's pretty clear that it just wasn't going to work in the sense that he hasn't come back. As 4 years pass, good old days when it was only 4 years in between Cure albums, we would get Blood Flowers later, co-produced by Paul Corkett. Like the others, he got his start engineering as well, gained attention with his work on Placebo's Without You I'm Nothing, a fantastic record. And shortly after, he would do the full-on producing for Black Market Music, also a great album. And Paul Corkett got into the Cure world by having done some of the many outsourced mixes for Wild Mood Swings. He did the final mix for Mint Carr, and that's always credited as landing him the gig for Blood Flowers in 2000, or I guess they started it before then, but it would come out in 2000. It sounds like it was a similar situation as Phil in Pornography, when he was initially hired on as an engineer, and over the course of the recording provided enough creative input to warrant the co-producer credit. And with Blood Flowers, the goal was to get back to the super cohesive album, since Wild Mood Swings was so scattered and all over the place. The Cure would return to St. Catherine's Court, where they did record Wild Mood Swings. And this time, though, they gave themselves, or somebody gave them, a three-month limit on recording, which was genius. They should have done this every album since. This actually helped keep the sessions focused and on task and intense. but focused. The vocals would be recorded back at Rack Studios in London, and then mixing done at The Farm in Surrey countryside. When it was all said and done, Blood Flowers was cohesive. So good job. Back to cohesive Cure albums. If anything, it's overly cohesive. But nobody's going to complain about that. So Paul Corkett helped him nail the sound. How much of that, you know, it's hard to tell. Was Robert knowing what worked with past Cure records? And, you know, Paul Corkett being a good wall to bounce ideas off of. Post Blood Flowers, Corkett has been working consistently, but not on too many familiar bands to me anyway. Bill No Mates, Queen at Arena, Fiction Plane, The Heavy in 2012. I know The Heavy. And most recognizable, Love Amongst Ruin, which I really only know is Placebo's drummer's other band, and Perry played bass for him for a minute. So not a ton of stuff, but consistent work. It's actually slightly odd that everyone seems to agree Bloodflower's production was a real highlight of the album. Tap back into the darker side, and even the songs that didn't really work that great, that aren't that great, still fit on the album and still sound great in tone and presentation. So why didn't they stick with Paul Corkett for the next album? Maybe he had another gig or something, and not for 413 either. So who knows? But we'll come back to Paul Corkett. So just put a little Corkett in it and hold on for a second. And we'll move on the Cure timeline here. Dun dun. 2003 is here, and The Cure is going to start recording a new album. And perhaps their most controversial producer on the list emerges, Mr. Ross Robinson from Angleton, Texas, 1967. A thrash metal guitarist, got his first taste of producing in 1991 with Fear Factory. But Korn's first album in 1994 put him on the map, and often cited as the birth of new metal. It's got rap, it's got metal, it's for meatheads, it's sweaty, it's for frat boy dude rock. Perhaps, I don't know, maybe those descriptions are an injustice. I know a lot of people that stick up for Korn's early shit and give Jonathan Davis praise for being a sensitive emo soul. And, you know, if it had just stopped there, fine. But Robinson goes on to produce Machine Head, Slipknot, fucking Limp Bizkit. Oh, yeah. The Deftones, which I know a lot of you also stand up for, but I respectfully will wait outside. Thanks. At the Drive-In, I know, gets a lot of good rock cred, but I don't necessarily enjoy it. Despite branching out to much cooler occasional tiers of alt rock, Ross Robinson becomes the undisputed go-to godfather of new metal. And that's hard to overlook for me. So, but not for Robert Smith. He was all about it, apparently. He met Ross Robinson backstage 2002 at a festival. Not only did Robert Smith get convinced to let Ross Robinson produce the next record, but they also signed to his friggin' label, IM, a subsidiary of Geffen. All the quotes from this time are overly flattering towards Ross Robinson, how he reawoken the love of rock music in Robert, convinced him they were going to make the defining Cure album a rebirth. Hence the decision to make the album named self-titled, It's a Cure. Or they just didn't have any good ideas. Who knows? But once recording started, all the love would get weird, as it always does. Stories of Ross Robinson getting the band pumped up by screaming at them, telling them that they should be ashamed of the crap they're playing. They're the Cure. Play it better. What the fuck? All of which I'm sure Robert secretly thought was hilarious as he's screaming at his bandmates. Because it did all seem to happen to the bandmates more. You don't really hear too many stories of him getting all in Robert's face and fucking spitting on him and stuff. But candles were thrown at Roger. air drumming in Jason's face was witnessed in the behind-the-scenes recording footage. Not sure what the hell he did to Simon, but he's been on the record of pretty much saying he would never work with that fucking guy again. Almost walked out like 5 times during the record. So strangely enough, as much as I can't stand nu metal and have to blame Ross Robinson for the mediocreness of self-titled as an album, I really don't have any objections to the sound of the album. All the guitar tones are pretty right on and the drums sound great. Everything's balanced pretty well. It's just the choices that were made, like not yelling on every song would have been a nice decision that the producer could have been like, let's try one more, but like with your indoor voice. And choosing all the like rock songs over anything with any hints of tenderness. So, I mean, those are all decisions that a producer can make. Again, I'm not sure, you know, maybe Robert is the one to blame for all this too, since he's mostly the songwriting, and that's where the album kind of falls short, in my opinion. Robert was clearly trying to prove that they could still rock and tap into a younger demographic. So, I'll always blame Ross Robinson over my boy Robert Smith, but I think they might be guilty on this one. Ross Robinson's post-2004 work is still pretty consistent, again, cranking out a few projects a year, even in some cases. Again, a lot of bands I'm not familiar with. I'm sure Antonio would know a lot of these more than me, for sure. Just randomly to name a few for the sake of the list. The First to Last, 2005. Was that the band that Antonio was like partying with in New Orleans? I gotta double check our own episode. But he recorded their album, Redeemer, Norma Jean, Black Light Burns, The Klaxons, Tech Nine, Cancer Bats, pretty cool name, Red Fang, The Used, Dead Cross, Suicide Silence. One surprisingly one that was on the list actually got me. I was going through like, what the fuck are all these bands? SoCo. Yeah, My Dreams Dictate My Reality. It's an actual album I know and like. She's normally a like kind of an indie folk singer, super French, and has a lot of really cool songs. But this is like an out of character kind of cool album that when I found it, I was like, whoa, SoCo is like totally doing Cure sounding shit. It's like blatantly obvious that she's doing like her take on Cure type songs. So I guess that's pretty funny. I wish Ross Robinson would have made a Cure album that sounded like The Cure with The Cure. But so apparently he's capable of it. So again, maybe Robert was the one that was like, no, make it sound like Limp Bizkit. So who the fuck knows? It's a cool record. Go check out that one. So I'll give you props for that one, Ross Robinson. Speaking of Ross Robinson, we probably will take a look at the anniversary of Self-Titled here. It might not be right on the date of when it came out, but 20 years on, let's give it another revisit. So I can happily eat my shoe, as they say, but I don't know if it's going to happen. I'm still not there. Let's move on to the final Cure album as of now, 413 Dream. Produced by Keith Udin. Yeah, his nickname is The Fade, but I don't know if Robert gave him that one. Maybe that's from something else. They call him The Fade. So, okay. Prior to crossing paths with Robert and company, Udin worked with Nick Cave, Paul McCartney, Madonna, No Doubt, Bjork, Oasis, and even the motherfucking Spice Girls. Woo! An engineer on all these, or some kind of technical assistant. So it was a lot of behind the scenes stuff before we get too excited. But that's a pretty fucking impressive list there, Keith Udin. So yeah, first Cure credit was engineering the Acoustic Greatest Hits collection. So that's where we first caught wind of Keith Udin. He's also credited as working on a lot of the reissues in the early 2000s, even the Disintegration and Entreat Plus. Mixed Up, Torn Down, Festival. As I'm saying all these now, they have like questionable production value. But yeah, he would do Bestival and the Curation CD. So, yeah, a lot of these he's just credited as tape transfer, which I'm not 100% sure what the hell that means. It seems kind of like a Bunny Lake job, if you know what I mean. But, you know, at least he was involved, and that's cool. But in 2008, he gets the keys to the kingdom as co-producer of 413 Dream. Still, as of now, the latest Cure album. This is another tricky one to look at from a production point of view, because 413 is pretty hit or miss, and more often than not, the production is considered the miss part. A lot of people are really hard on the production of this album. You know, I'm not super anti all of it, but there is just something weird about it that doesn't quite click. The vocals are cranked, the guitars get kind of muddy, the layer upon layers seem to just get caked on, which is mostly odd just because that's the Cure's forte, you know, getting all these layers together and being cohesive. But a lot just doesn't sit right. And much like Ross Robinson, it's a lot easier to just blame Keith Udin than Robert Smith. But probably equally to blame, like, you know, he'd been doing it for a while by this point. He knows how a Cure record's supposed to be sounding, and it's just not quite the face melting that previous Cure production would have on their albums. And being on the younger side, I can't imagine that he was like challenging or pushing Robert too hard in any new directions. So he was probably the flip side of how Ross Robinson was. That attempt of going with a different kind of producer and pushing him, and actually for the most part being a producer that Robert was working with. In this case, it feels again like it's Robert and this producer's working with Robert. So since 2008, the Fades credits kind of fade out, actually. I think he's still done more engineer work than like full-on producing. So yeah, kind of on the technical side of things, which, you know, still keeps him in the Cure camp of doing those reissues and such that came out after 2008's work. A strange footnote from the Curepedia in 2009, so right after 413 Dream's release, Udin was slated to work on Michael Jackson's This Is It residency at the O2 Arena in London. Apparently, MJ and his crew were really impressed with his work on 413 in specific and wanted him on board. They wanted him to like build a studio and set a path basically to produce the next Michael Jackson album too. Unfortunately for Udin, but not unfortunately for the rest of the world, Michael Jackson died before any of this could materialize. So it did prove to be This Is It after all. And the residency did not happen. So here's the million-dollar question then, as we wrap up the albums that do exist. Songs of a Lost World. Yep, the answer was actually given, if you can remember that far back and those details of everything that leads to Songs of a Lost World. But Roger had tweeted on November 8th, 2022 at 6:20 a.m., that's what kind of nerd I've become. I actually save it now so I can pull these wonderful nuggets out. But Roger tweeted, Paul produced Bloodflowers and is producing the new record. And he also mixes our front of house sound. A very good / old friend. Paul being Paul Corkett, producer of Bloodflowers. So unpop the cork, he's back. Hopefully. I mean, at this point, every fucking producer that they've ever worked with could have done a version of this album, but we can assume, until otherwise told, that when and if this new album comes out, Paul Corkett had a hand in co-producing it with Robert Smith. And like I said, this was November 2022, so this was during the Euro leg of the Songs of a Lost World tour. yeah. Producer of Bloodflowers, which is great because even if you didn't love Bloodflowers, everybody was pretty cool with the production side of Bloodflowers. And like I said, he should have been working with them all along. Self-titled album, 413. And it seems like he's a good friend and they click well together. So that's pretty much all you could ask for. And you know, given the songs that we have heard live from Songs of a Lost World, It feels like, and that's what we've been predicting, is that it will be a better version of Blood Flowers, you know, a very somber record with no glaring pop singles, but hopefully produced and layered well enough to bring back that classic Cure style and sound. So, is Paul Corkett our hero, our savior that's going to right the ship at the end on the final chapter of The Cure? Who knows? First thing we got to do is hear the album, right? So, leads us to this path again. So, here we are. So, in conclusion, instead of just ending on a "so what is up with the new album" rant, I think we can look back at all these guys and really see that, one, Robert is a huge part of it, obviously. He was taking notes early on and consistently and constantly through all these years, and everything that he brought in to a new producer still, you know, challenged and made for great Cure records. I think Mike Hedges is got to get huge props for those early albums. I think Dave Allen is the god of the golden era for Cure production. But, you know, we have gems sprinkled through all these. So all these guys really help make the albums we love. I don't think, as much as I harp on the self-titled album, even, like I said, the production's fine. So there's gems in all of them. So you can't really say any of these producers were complete dog shit and ruined the Cure or anything. So very cool. If I had one to choose to bring back for the new album, realistically, I'm cool with Paul Corkett. You know, of course, my heart lies with Dave. I think that'd be cool. I think it'd be awesome to see him work with Phil Thornalley again and see what they could come up with. But I think all big bands are tempted to go back to their peak awesomeness and everything that worked in that production. I just wish there's a little more time somehow. It doesn't quite seem to be something that's possible that would fit in a world to get Dave Allen and Robert to produce a Cure album again. But who knows? You know, stranger things have happened, right? So let's wrap it up there. I hope you learned a little something. I hope you got thinking about production when you listen to these records again for the 5,000th time. Maybe you'll hear some cool little feedback or backwards noise or just a extra little production tip probably that wasn't in there, still isn't in there when they play it live, but it's just always in there on the recording. And think of those producers and how cool it was to have that idea in the moment and be like, let's add a finger clip, let's add breathing on Close to Me. Somebody came up with that. So all right, guys, thank you so much for listening and bearing with me here solo. I'm on the road here, so this has been a bit of a shoot from the hip kind of episode. So thanks for putting up with me. And this is going to be a quick but hopefully poignant Patreon shout out as we conclude our episode, getting the bare bones out here. Please join our Patreon. Go to patreon.com/theholyhourpodcast. And you can be in the ranks of Donna, Craig, Jeff Hilton, Jeff, Cortland, Jones, Sue, Ben, John, Alan, Allison, Dion, Namisio, Matt, Danny, Coulter, Matt Ford, Tom Johnson, Tom Burns, Letty, John Roberts, Francisco, Jason, Bunny Lake, Amber, Nicholas, Arno, Chad, Shirley, Jason Hall, and of course Tanya, who is also part of the team. And would like to spread awareness of 988lifeline.org, suicide and crisis hotline with over 200 crisis call centers located all over the U.S., available 24/7, offering free and confidential support for people in distress and numerous prevention and crisis resources. Call or chat online if you or anyone you know is in need of help. Scott Kruger, of course, is part of the Sarlacc Digest, the best Star Wars podcast out there in the galaxy and beyond. They are on every Wednesday evening, 8 p.m. Pacific time on YouTube, or catch the replays anywhere that you listen to podcasts. And be sure to catch their alternating Monday shows on YouTube as well. They got the Sarlacc Toy Chest that focuses on the collector side of things, and Beyond the Pit, which is all things pop culture related. And of course, we got Tim over at Waterloo, New Waterloo, an independent hospitality development, design, and management company. Dana is a freelance animation, illustration, and motion graphics designer, currently open to new work and commissions. Check out her amazing portfolio at graphics.tv. That's graphics with an X.tv. It could be just the kickstart that your business or project needs. Kate is always hard at work at curethreads.com. Go on over there, check out an original Cure-inspired design or artwork on a wide variety of products. And be sure to follow Cure Arts Collab on Instagram, where she pulls together Cure-inspired artwork from fans like you. And they have a new project going all the time, so go check out the theme. And if it isn't too late, you can participate in it too, or just admire the fine artwork by Cure fans. Lisa recommends you check out Dickens in Calgary, Canada, if you want to catch a great show or event. See their full schedule of upcoming shows at dickensyyc.com, or check out clubnevermore.com down in Little Rock, Arkansas. Take Jessica's word for it. They'll have a full listing of cool goth-inspired dance parties or events. Find your people at clubnevermore.com. And of course, don't forget to check out Chaz's other podcast, The Excommunication Station, where he, Donovan, and Chrissy dive into life in the church, the often dark and mysterious life of what really goes on in church life. Ooh, all right. So good luck over there. Follow them. New episodes every week. And that's for you guys. Thank you again for listening. If you would be so kind to subscribe, leave a comment on Apple. It's always fun and appreciated. And you can always email me at gavinconnor@gmail.com. And please follow us on all the social media biz. We have a wonderful, I don't know what the hell's coming up next, actually, so I'll come up with something. Don't worry. We'll catch you soon. Hopefully we'll get some real Cure news going here soon. And I hope you guys are keeping safe out there. Thank you so much, as always, and we'll talk to you soon. Talk hard.